It's Tuesday, October 8th, and this is the Daily Medical News, where we bring you the top clinical medicine headlines of the day, plus an in-depth look at today's biggest story. I'm Terry Rudd.
And I'm Mary Ellen Schneider. Today, vaping-related lung injuries may be cases of chemical pneumonitis.
Massachusetts takes the top spot in state vaccination rankings.
How reframing the way patients view osteoporosis can improve medication adherence.
And the viral cause of acute flaccid myelitis continues to elude detection.
Plus, why substance use disorder should prompt you to look for accompanying comorbidities.
Vaping-associated lung injury is likely a form of airway-centered chemical pneumonitis, not exogenous lipoid pneumonia. That's the observation from researchers at the University of Texas Southwestern Medical Center in Dallas. Their analysis appears in the New England Journal of Medicine. The investigators reviewed lung biopsies from 17 patients with a history of vaping and either suspected or confirmed vaping-associated lung injury. All cases showed patterns of acute lung injury, including acute fibrinous pneumonitis, diffuse alveolar damage, or organizing pneumonia. None of the histologic findings was specific, but foamy macrophages and pneumocyte vaccuolization were seen in all cases. The researchers say their findings call into question the diagnostic utility of identifying lipid-laden macrophages or performing oil red O staining on bronchioloalveolar lavage fluid as a marker of vaping-associated lung injury.
U.S. vaccination policy is set largely at the state level, and no state does a better job at vaccinating than Massachusetts. That's according to a new analysis from personal finance website Wallet Hub. The Bay State's top finish in the children and teenagers immunization rates category moved it ahead of Vermont in the overall rankings. But Vermont had the highest score in each of the other two broad categories: adult and elderly vaccination rates, and immunization uptake disparities in influencing factors. The state that ranked 51st in child-teen immunization, Mississippi, also finished 51st overall, behind every other state and Washington, D.C. The rest of the bottom five consisted of Texas, Florida, Georgia, and Indiana.
Dr. Deborah Gold of Duke University in Durham, North Carolina, has a message for those treating osteoporosis. The language of the disease needs to be changed. Reframing the decision-making process for picking osteoporosis treatments could boost adherence to medication. Speaking at the annual meeting of the American Society for Bone and Mineral Research, Dr. Gold said medications for osteoporosis have changed. So have delivery mechanisms and dosage intervals. What hasn't changed much is long-term adherence to osteoporosis medications. The emphasis in the lay press on rare and frightening side effects hasn't helped matters. And that's helped create a gap between clinical recommendations and patient perceptions. Dr. Gold recommends countering negative patient perceptions by explaining the risks of treatment and the risks of not undergoing treatment. As she puts it, a hip fracture is a lot more likely for non-treatment than the rare frightening side effects are for treatment. It's also important to listen to patients' treatment preferences and try to find an appropriate treatment they're likely to continue using. And assure your patients that they can visit again anytime to address issues with treatment, change medications if needed, and discuss concerns about adverse outcomes. We'll be back with more medical news after this message.
A study of 305 cases of acute flaccid myelitis has revealed further evidence of viral etiology. But researchers still haven't been able to identify a single pathogen as the primary cause. Investigators from the National Center for Immunization and Respiratory Diseases analyzed patients with acute flaccid limb weakness from January 2015 to December 2017 across 43 states. they found that 83% of patients had experienced fever, cough, runny nose, vomiting, and/or diarrhea for a median of 5 days before limb weakness began. Two-thirds of patients had experienced a respiratory illness, 62% had experienced a fever, and 29% had experienced gastrointestinal illness. Among 72 patients who had serum specimens tested at the CDC, two were positive for enteroviruses. Among the 90 patients who had upper respiratory specimens tested, 36% were positive for either enteroviruses or rhinoviruses. No single pathogen was identified as the primary cause of acute flaccid myelitis, but the researchers say signs point to a viral etiology, including symptoms of a viral syndrome within the week before limb weakness. The detection of viral pathogens from sterile and non-sterile sites from almost half of patients, and the seasonality of the condition's incidence. The findings appear in the journal Pediatrics.
Substance abuse disorders rarely ride alone, and that makes it crucial to treat the accompanying mental illness that's almost always present. As Dr. Timothy Willens of Harvard Medical School and Massachusetts General Hospital in Boston explains, if you're really depressed and you're smoking marijuana, the smoking could have made it worse, but you were probably depressed before. In ADHD, for example, Dr. Willens says you need to consider the big picture. If a patient has both ADHD and SUD, treat both if the level of substance abuse is lower. But focus on the SUD in more severe ADHD cases, and realize that most likely your treatment for ADHD isn't going to work as well. When you're using stimulants in people with use disorders, you have to use high doses, Dr. Willens explains. The same goes for the anxiolytic buspirone in patients with depression and SUD. If you work with this population and treat ADHD or anxiety, you're paranoid that everyone coming in wants to scam medicines. But Dr. Willens says substance abuse research suggests that users of pharmaceutical drugs for non-medical uses rarely get them directly from practitioners. Instead, they mainly get them through friends. That means clinicians should be more concerned about oversupplying patients with immediate release medications and about making sure they're keeping the medications safely stored. For more of Dr. Willens' perspectives from the Psych Congress 2019, click the link in the podcast notes. And that's it for today's Daily Medical News. Remember, you can find us on Apple Podcasts, Google Podcasts, Spotify, and YouTube. For MD Edge, I'm Terry Rudd.
And I'm Mary Ellen Schneider. Thanks for listening.